hungry for Jesus Christ. Are you thirsty today? Because I don't want another religion in my life. I left religion. I left Islam. I hate it. I just want to be free. I just want to be free. And then something happens to that person. A touch or a breeze or in a form of a wind. I know it is Jesus. Maybe you are sitting here today and you are saying, I need that transformation because I don't want to be stuck in this place anymore. Now this is the biggest harvest time. This is the revival time for God to come and change everything.
Friends, welcome to Embracing New Life Dream Church. This is live right now, and so good to be with you because I miss each and every one of you. As many of you know, I host a live Christian program to Turkey and to the Muslim world. This year, we have seen a great increase in calls, messages, and on-air salvations. Hallelujah! Praise the Lord! Today, we are joined by a very special guest from my home country who has helped share the gospel of Jesus Christ in a great deal. She is the country director of Rabbi Zacharias International Ministry in Turkey. How awesome is that? Please welcome with me my dear friend, evangelist and apologist, Senem Ekener.
Hello.
Hi, how are you, Senem?
I am so blessed and so happy to be here. Finally.
Finally.
I remember the days many years ago that you mentioned that we would get together on your program. And a huge greetings to all your audience around the world.
Oh, thank you
they
so much.
So for, precious for you.
Thank you so much for being with us. What a privilege to have you here. It's Rabbi Zacharias. I love Rabbi Zacharias Ministries. Yes. And I love you. It's a privilege
thank
to have you.
Thank you so much. That's the privilege is mine, actually, that finally
thank
that
you.
I'm able to be here with you on the program.
Thank you, Senem. Mm-hmm. Before you became a Christian, you have a background that mm-hmm. I would like to know, and I would like my audience to know as well. Would you share with us how you became a Christian, your journey to Christianity?
Sure. I mean, it's a wonderful way that God actually calls for us and mm-hmm. then finds us. So, and it's such a distinction between Christianity, our belief in Jesus, and the rest of what they call religion around the world, that it's God's mission, actually. He comes after us and finds us to himself, rather than us looking for him. So mine was kind of like that also. I was born and raised in the seven churches of Revelation area. It used to be the Asia Minor, as you know. Mm-hmm. I was born in the very area of the Church of Philadelphia that one of the letters were written.
Wow.
By Apostle John. So, of course, little did I know after I became a believer that how significant that area was for the gospel. And I was raised in Smyrna, which is Izmir, so the Aegean coast area, which used to be the cradle of Christianity. And we've been praying that, you know, the revival will come back to that land. Mine was a very happy childhood. My parents are teachers, and I had a very traditional nominal Islamic upbringing, but nonetheless, of course, this long summer months were spent in the mosque reciting the Quranic verses and in a communal way more than anything else. My parents had very high ethical values, but I never had a basis of why they were, you know, demanding such high values from me. And, you know, the traditional holidays, festivals. So it was a very secular, but at the same time, very traditional Muslim upbringing.
Sure.
Yeah. And until, actually, it continued until I came to Smyrna for studying for the high school degree, and then moved to Istanbul to pursue my BA in philosophy.
Wow, so. You are a philosopher by trade.
By trade, yeah. I mean, it's a heavy word to call yourself a philosopher, and it carries lots of questions with it, but it's enough to just actually play with your mind in a mighty way for many years.
Absolutely.
Yeah, let's put it that way. But throughout all these years, I mean, I've experienced loneliness more than anything else, and this huge ongoing debate in my mind never... straight from God, but didn't know him either.
Sure.
And during my university years, as I was studying philosophy, I've read the Quran several times and found great contradictions and limitations of how God would communicate to his people. Mm-hmm. And during that time, I've completely rejected as my faith, but never gave up a belief in God. Mm-hmm. Because always I had this huge yearning in my life towards good and bad, how I would differentiate and why I would feel so uncomfortable when I was doing bad. Of course, I didn't know that it was sin. Anything against God's will or sure. his desire is sin, of course.
Because we are a guilt and shame
based culture
and yeah. it is always guilt and shame.
Yes,
and you are. Whatever slept. You do, there's this always a slap. And yeah. we understand God of Islam in that way as well.
Unfortunately.
Yes, but I always say that there's no single Muslim on the face of the earth that they are not seeking God.
Oh, absolutely.
But the question is which God, right?
Sure. And what kind of a nature he carries with it.
Absolutely.
Because we have such a distorted understanding of God's nature. Mm-hmm. And when I share with my Muslim friends, it's one of the first avenues, actually, that I go after. Just describe to me who God is for you, you know, what he does, what kind of attributes you have about him. What is the proof of that also?
Sure.
And then, of course, you know, you have the father nature of God and you have the creator nature of God mm-hmm. and judge side of God.
we only knew judge side
exactly,
of angry God,
exactly.
right?
Yeah. But you can never speak about that if you don't know his loving nature.
Absolutely.
Because it just comes together. Yeah.
But it is amazing that you said that you disassociated with Islam.
Yes.
Just before any exposure to Christianity.
At all, yes. Exactly.
So you still believe in God.
I did believe in God, but in my very prideful nature, mm-hmm. just rejecting any mediator at all, as if that I was holy enough to stand before him and just deal, with him. But I use this term, of course, very carefully, that most of us are agnostic in that way in Turkey, and
yes.
so many people still
yes.
carry that. But you treat him like a heavenly butler in a way, mm-hmm. that whenever you need him, all of a sudden that you mm-hmm. find yourself in prayer, not knowing, you know, who you are addressing and how holy he is and, you know, how worthy he is of your own life.
Sure.
But in the moment of your, you know, great need, not as the first one.
Yeah, I always say sometimes we treat God like the genie in the Aladdin's,
yes.
you know, magical lamp.
Yes,
and
that's true.
Whenever we need it, we want him to show up.
Exactly.
And
exactly.
he's our mate, but we don't serve him, he serves us.
Exactly.
And we have to get rid of that belief.
Exactly.
Right.
But through those years also, I was suffering greatly in the heart issues, mm-hmm. always trying to grasp him with my mind, understanding, knowledge, or search, yet at the same time, just being so desperate or so tired of carrying the burdens of life, which yes. wasn't to carry me in the first place.
You know,
I was 16 when I was in Istanbul, didn't have any role models whatsoever, mm-hmm. so made so many mistakes during those years and felt in great bondage. In the worldly terms, you know, that we describe it as freedom. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, that's now that actually we are free to choose good. That is the real freedom, is I call it that way.
Absolutely.
You know, the other one is that if you don't have any limitations or God's knowledge of understanding how you function in the world, it qualifies as bondage.
Absolutely.
And that is the real freedom that Jesus gives us, so we can live free.
That's so wonderful.
Yeah.
So how were you exposed to Christianity while you were kind of in an agnostic state? I am very interested because my brother calls himself agnostic right now.
Oh, good.
He said that you messed me up to me because he was a Muslim.
Okay.
After my conversion, now he's like, I don't know. But
okay.
I believe in the existence of God.
That's
just
good.
Like you said.
Yes.
But he has to reveal himself to me if he's Jesus Christ.
Okay, yeah.
And I am like, this is my prayer. And I want to hear how you were exposed to Christianity.
Yeah. I think your brother is in a journey.
Yes.
Because every one of us individuals in God's eyes, mm-hmm. you know, he treats us so individually and in the way that he has designed us to be.
Yes.
So I don't think we can ever measure each other journeys into one another.
Absolutely.
Yet at the same time, there are so many similarities in the journey. And it continues until he's coming back.
Yes.
So they are yet to know Jesus. That's how I look at it.
Absolutely.
Full of hope, of course. So during my university years, actually, I've met during that time, he was just my boyfriend, now my husband, who was from the first generation of Turkish believers in the country from early 80s, 1980s. And he's done his share of searching and come to know that Jesus was the true God. And he was a believer, a growing believer in the Turkish church.
I hate to interrupt. By the way, your husband was and is a very famous comedian, right?
Yeah, yes, he's an actor by profession.
Okay, I want to say actor, but he's also known as a comedian.
Yes, that's right.
I always told the Lord, please make me a stand-up comedian, but instead he made me a TV evangelist.
Yes, you can still use that desire Absolutely. For him here. Yes, and you tell stories.
Yes.
You know, that's how a stand-up comedian acts. So it's great that it's given. So his faith was very influential in my conversion. Wow. Of course, at the beginning, I was a bit more like Saul Paul. By his actually recommendation, I read the Bible, and it was just like a history book for me. I've started almost mocking it with my philosophy skills, which I'm very ashamed of now.
Sure.
But I've done it. I mean, thank God, interesting enough, that God has erased those memories. All through that time, my friends still call me, you know, how you were mocking the book and all that. But I don't remember it anymore, which is wonderful.
Sure.
Anyway, so his way of living before me was very exemplary in his Christian walk. So I'm one of those spouses in Paul's letters that you know, the husband or wife's fate would bring the spouse to the
salvation,
kingdom.
Yes.
Salvation. He always said that he had such a strong belief or promise from the Lord that I was the one for him. Of course, he suffered the church discipline very rightly during the time of our courtship and engagement. And it was 2 years after we were married that I became a believer, when I was on my own.
So he didn't convert you to marry you.
No.
Kind of he rebelled a little bit there, right?
Yes, actually. He always said that he obeyed God's calling, but there were consequences, of course, of making that decision.
Yes.
But, you know, God's grace is way wider and deeper than our understanding of it.
So he did a missionary courting with you.
Yes. I mean, I don't think it was the plan. He always, you know, still says that he was in love with me.
Yes.
And I want to, you know, believe that. I do believe that. But I didn't know in detail why I was pursuing this relationship, because my parents are divorced, so I come from a dysfunctional family as well. But one thing I was certain of, that my relationship with my husband was the most valuable thing for me in my life.
Wow.
Although that I was making so many mistakes on the other side's career or worldly desires of being accomplished in life, because that was the upbringing I had. It was very conditional. You need to perform well in a secular setting.
Yes.
And early independence financially or living conditions, it all actually damaged my soul deeper and deeper. So when I was with him, it was like fresh breath.
Wow.
It was wonderful, the peace that he brought, which I couldn't name it, of course. It came later on. And but interestingly enough, when I was finally cornered by God and Holy Spirit, he wasn't with me. It was through one of the lowest point of our lives and our relationship. Because he was almost at the point of admitting that this was a mistake that he made. And he was almost giving up on me. And telling God, okay, God, probably I made a mistake. And that was the time I finally reached to a point that I was no longer my own God in my life. I couldn't control the circumstances. I couldn't control the deep wounds in my heart or the burdens that I was carrying. It was just too much for me. During that time, we were acquainted with the church. And the ladies, of course, just loved on me. So there are like many different elements of my conversion. My husband's love was first, and then the prayer power of the church. You know, yes. They never gave up on prayer for me. And they were, I was never a project for them. I was a person to be loved and valued. And mm-hmm. I mattered to them no matter what. Yes. I always emphasize that this is so valuable in God's eyes.
Yes.
That, you know, it's first the love and care we have for the other person. Mm-hmm. And I was an example or a fruit of that. Labor of love.
Wow. I just want to tell people right now, okay, in my book, there's no missionary dating, okay? If yes. somebody is an unbeliever, you are not going to date that person. Please yes. listen yes. to me very carefully. Unless really God is calling you to do that. And I know a lot of people marry to wrong people mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. because they think that I'm going to convert him. And no, at the beginning, not. Maybe they do, and they seem like they are interested. After the marriage, you're in the pocket,
yeah.
and it is not as easy. I just want you to open your eyes and ears and listen to me.
Yes.
Your sister is speaking to you. And the other thing I want you to know that Senem said, she received unconditional love of God from those church ladies. Mm-hmm. She was not a project
no.
that another number of conversion. We gotta convert her.
We
gotta love her.
Yeah.
We gotta love her first. We're gonna respect who she is, what she believes. And we are going to just put our arms around her, sometimes through our behaviors or sometimes through prayers. So I just want you to really meditate on this mm-hmm. today, that if you are thinking missionary dating, I would call it, you know, light and darkness does not associate. But when you're in a land like Turkey, it is so difficult mm-hmm. to find a believing husband or believing wife because the numbers are very low. Mm-hmm. But I'm telling you, please open your eyes and listen to me, that unless really you hear from the Lord, there's like a big banner on the sky and, you know, all these fireworks and everything telling you, marry him,
yeah.
marry her, don't do that. Mm-hmm. Okay, so how did you become a Christian?
Thank
what
you so much you? For that clarification. Yes. It's very important. I yes. mean, yeah, thanks for telling your sure. audience that. So it was just one night before Christmas 2002 only mm-hmm. that he was not with me. He was in another city filming a movie. And it was one of those moments that I was literally just cornered. I was just so heavy in my spirit, couldn't control anything. I was about to lose the most precious thing in my life, which was my marriage to my husband. And finally, I just took a very small step of faith and surrendering, actually. Mm-hmm. And previously, I was given a promise Bible, which underlined God's promises in your life. So I want the audience to see all the elements of my conversion. It was God's living word also present.
Absolutely. Wow.
Without I realize, you know, how powerful it was. So I just read those and I simply said that I am so tired and I cannot grasp you fully in my mind. Mm-hmm. But he works in this amazing way of reaching through the heart.
Yes.
And just felt Holy Spirit in a very powerful way. So my missionaries were actually God and Holy Spirit. I became friends with Jesus later on,
yes.
that's how I say it. So it was the moment of conversion, and I was filled with Holy Spirit in a very strong way for
right
a
there.
Long time. Yes,
wow.
For a long time, which opened my eyes mm-hmm. And just triggered an unprecedented hunger for God's word, mm-hmm. which wasn't there before mm-hmm. at all. So I had to tell my husband over the phone. He couldn't believe it, of mm-hmm. course. He checked with the church members. You know, she's telling me this weird thing happened to her. But it was an amazing, amazing wow. conversion experience. Nothing that I would even know that existed. Mm-hmm. So little by little, I was just so thirsty for his word, just reading and studying it. And my conversion was 180 degrees, I mm-hmm. say that. And it continues, you know,
yes.
his replenishing continues every day. I need for him never ceases to be.
Absolutely.
And I want to say this. This is God's mission, actually, that he comes and rescues us. I was healed from all the infirmities mm-hmm. I had in my life. Also, he has fixed the things that I didn't even know existed.
Absolutely.
So renewal of the mind, mm-hmm. the heart, and the spirit, because we are created in his image. So he never sees us as one dimension.
I like that.
So he sees us as a whole mm-hmm. and ministers to us in our spirit, soul, and also in our minds, that he wants us to love him with our minds as well, but also just fills us with his love in our hearts. So that's the only way that we're able to love other people with that.
Wow. So share him. So how did your decision affect your marriage afterwards?
It was again, it was a rescue. We were united again as a believer husband and wife.
Yes.
And Jesus was with us through that all. So I was baptized in a year later. Of course, now my husband thinks that he overprayed, actually. I ended up in ministry.
Now he has a wife who is an evangelist, apologist of Rabbi Zacharias ministry in Turkey. Wow.
So, yeah, it changed a lot. It changed a lot. But you know what? I want to communicate this to your audience also. He never ceases us as before and after conversion, because we always carry the word that he gives us from the beginning, which is distorted by other people or the sinful nature of the world itself.
Sure.
So he sees every element of what he has given us or the experiences we have before we become a believer.
Sure.
So I was praying through all these, education or talents that he's given me, and he started to use them one by one.
Yes, not right away. You became the director of Rabbi Zacharias Ministries for Turkey.
I mean, I couldn't even dream of a life like this, so fulfilled by his spirit and his love. It came later on, but I always yearned for more of him, because there's nothing in this world that would even come close to satisfy me in what it has, because it's fallen.
Yes.
It has fallen.
The amazing thing that you were a philosopher, and it just reminds me of, I'm going to wrap it up the program. They are telling me it's time.
Oh, okay.
So, but I just want to speak to you this. You know, from the First Corinthians first chapter, it just reminds me of God chose the foolish things of the world to shame the wise. And Paul starts with, where is the philosopher of this age?
Yeah.
Where is the wise man? God does not God choose the foolish things of the world to shame the wise? So he starts just speaking into our lives, that our intellect, our wisdom, our philosophy, psychology cannot save us. So we need the supernatural power of God.
Yes.
And I heard someone said long time ago, I don't know, maybe you agree, philosophers are the people that who take simple things and make it very complicated.
Right?
So when you read a quote from a philosopher, you are like, wow, this is deep. You keep thinking about that.
Yes.
There is no power of the Holy Spirit unless it's a Christian philosophy.
Exactly. And Paul does that in Acts, actually, where he debates the Greek philosophers by using it. But he creates a bridge.
So it's good.
It is a wonderful way of reaching out to those people. Mm-hmm. And he uses the poets as an example, also the philosophers.
That's right.
But then, how it connects to the gospel message.
That's very powerful.
Yeah.
And then you see, philosophers taking simple things complicated, then Jesus came, made complicated things simple. Mm-hmm. This is what I love about Jesus. He spoke simple. He said, I am the bread of life.
Yes.
I am the living water. I am the way, truth, and the life. No one goes to the Father except through me. People, theologians, and all these doctrines and everything make stuff complicated. But Jesus wanted to make everything so simple for us. And he said, I love you. And it didn't stop there, that it was only a bunch of words. He went to the cross for you and me and for all of us. So we need that simple love message in our lives to be completed. And when Paul said, where is the philosopher? Where is it? Where is the intelligence? Where is the guy with the PhD? Show me that guy. God's wisdom is more powerful than all of these philosophers, doctors, lawyers, put everybody all together. All together in one place, God has a bigger wisdom than all of them. Mm-hmm. This is why still there are things in creation is a mystery.
Yes.
You cannot explain it.
Yes.
And this is why nobody can explain miracles. I know how many people got healed during their conversion time yes. with Jesus, and
yeah.
they got healed and doctors could not explain it.
Exactly.
And if they could explain it, it wouldn't be a miracle, right?
Yeah, yeah. And it's only from the observations. Mm-hmm. And there are ways, sides of us that received miracles,
yes.
but we're not even in knowledge of them. That
Absolutely.
God does those things. And no, they're not visible.
And isn't salvation a supernatural experience?
It is. It certainly is. And it reflects the Trinity nature of God.
Yes.
Because that is a mystery, you know. We can Absolutely. Only know until a certain level because we are the created
it's
ones.
It's so true.
Yeah. So actually it resembles the Trinity mm-hmm. nature when the salvation happens, you know, the Word, the Spirit, and the wisdom of God. Mm-hmm. I was reading from Old Testament this morning, and it just goes so well with what you just experienced, I mean, explained to us. That when God asks Solomon what he wants, he asks for knowledge
yes.
and wisdom.
Wow.
And then he responds, God responds, you will receive knowledge and wisdom. Because
both of
if
them.
It's yeah, if it's just knowledge, as you said, it's
meaningless. Information.
If we have God's wisdom mm-hmm. with the knowledge, and then we are able to actually communicate his redeeming message to the wider world.
Yes.
And because of that, of course, the rest was given to him, uh-huh. which brings us to the New Testament message that you first seek God's kingdom and the rest will be given to you.
That's right.
That's first that we, you know, we crave for that.
And how awesome is that?
It is amazing.
We have this amazing church that became a mosque and then they turn into a museum and they are planning to turn
yes.
it into a mosque right now. We
have
an Islamic government. And yeah. then it is Hagia Sophia. Sophia means God's wisdom,
wisdom,
right?
Sacred wisdom.
Sacred wisdom,
yes.
holy wisdom of
yes,
God.
Holy
so
wisdom
how
of God.
How awesome is this?
It
if
is.
Anybody has, you know, daughters or granddaughters named Sophia,
yes.
it means godly wisdom.
Mm-hmm.
It's so powerful.
It is. It is
so,
powerful.
Yes.
It just shapes us, which is just beyond measure.
Yes.
Beyond measure.
Absolutely. Because yeah. earthly wisdom, James talks about mm-hmm. it, that it is demonic. He mm-hmm. says it. Okay, you guys know that I do deliverance ministry, I use demonic, but really Bible is talking about
yeah.
demonic. Earthly wisdom is demonic.
Mm-hmm.
So whenever you are trying to solve things with earthly wisdom, you are right now listening to the enemy's voice
mm-hmm.
because he's a wise supernatural being. But forget all of these things. How awesome is that? We are two Muslim background
yeah.
believers here today. Two Muslim background believers serving in the ministry to Jesus Christ. Somebody says, hallelujah, praise
Amen.
The Lord.
Yes.
This is just a miraculous power of
it is.
God.
It is.
You know, Senem is one of the most mature believers that I know in Turkey. This is amazing. And today I just want to invite you,
mm.
seek God's wisdom.
Yes.
Seek God. Seek Holy Spirit is called Spirit of Truth.
Yes.
Seek Spirit of Truth in your life to answer your questions.
Amen.
And go to Him. Seek Him wholeheartedly. Until next program, we are going to have another program
yes.
today. Please stay with us. God bless you. I love you, Dream Church. Thank you for watching us today. And thank you, Senem.
Thank you for having me.
This program is made possible by friends and partners of Ishik Abla Ministries. If you'd like to support our ministry, please go to our website at www.ishikabla.com. There you can make a secure, tax-deductible donation. Our vision is to proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ with a message of salvation, freedom, and healing for the transformation of the Muslim world and bring revival to the body of Christ. We thank you for your support.